Good morning. Good morning. Well, we're going to go three times this charm, right? Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, I love it. I love it. Now, welcome everyone to our 60th anniversary symposium. We're going to try to go to the next slide there. Let's go one back. No, it's my fault. So there we go. So again, I want to thank everybody for being here. Now, we've got a good, we're just now starting to have a few more people in today. We're going to have another busload that's going to slide in as we get started here. The traffic is bad coming from Griffin Gate, so they're still delayed a little bit. So we apologize for some of the alumni may catch us a little bit on the run, but we're going to go ahead and get started because we have a great program for you here today. One of the things someone asked me last night, why a 60th? Right, it's not a 40th, it's not a 50th, it's not a 75th, and I think the part of it is that we really hadn't taken the time. I mean, why do you celebrate? Why do you have an anniversary? And if you think about it, it reminds us, and I think it's been great. It was great last night to hear, because we have a lot of people that haven't been here in 30 years. They haven't seen even the Gill Pavilion, much less Pavilion A, and all the work that's gone on. So I think reminding us what we've done and all the things we've accomplished, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. The other thing is it emphasizes what has gone well and what we have to continue to do. We're going to talk about the future today, but it also will reiterate the things that we have to work on in our state and in our country to improve the health. And I think that's who we are, right? That is us moving forward to try to make a difference in the health of Kentucky. It grounds us in the present. Again, the same thing. What are some of those challenges we have to face? And it paves the way. And we have a lot of great things that we're going to be doing over the next 60 years, starting now with the great leadership we have and the great people that are a part of this place. And it is about the people. It is about the great people doing things and about our alumni and us working together to try to achieve all the different things that we want to be able to do and to build momentum to be able to do that. Now, I wanted to reiterate, especially for the alumni, that, you know, who we are now, because it's very different than who we were even 10 years ago. If we look at our total number of licensed beds, 1,086, 40,000 discharges a year, more than 15,000 transfers, we're one of the top, depending on the year, anywhere from number one in the nation to number five to 10 in the nation in the transfers that we take from other hospitals. We're that regional medical center that needs to be there. We're one of only 29 academic medical centers that have a CTSA award, an NCI designated cancer center, together with an Alzheimer's disease research center. So we're proud of the work we do. One of the top, according to U.S. News report, hospital in the country, and we have more than doubled our NIH funding in the last 5 years. So we're proud of where we are, but we know that we have a lot of challenges going forward. And the vision, when we think about our broader vision, our vision is about one community committed to creating a healthier Kentucky. And that's what we'll talk about today. And a lot of the questions is, how are the things we push forward? How do we use technology? How do we work smarter and not necessarily harder to accomplish all the goals that we want to over time? So it's an opportunity for us, and we've got some great speakers today to talk about some of the work that we're going to do. And our first speaker is Dr. Daniel Kraft. Dr. Kraft is a Stanford and Harvard-trained physician scientist, innovator, entrepreneur. Again, he has served as the founder and chair of Exponential Medicine, a program that explores convergent and rapidly developing technologies and their potentials for biomedicine and healthcare. Daniel was board certified in both internal medicine and pediatrics after completing a Harvard residency at MGH and Boston Children's, and his fellowships in hematology, oncology, and bone marrow transplants at Stanford. He's going to be talking today on the future of health and medicine, from hospital to home, where can technology take us? And with me, please help me recognize Dr. Daniel Kraft.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Let's see if we can get the technology to work. I'm sharing my screen. Can you pull it over? There we go. And if I can get the start button. All right. Great. Thank you so much. It's a real honor and pleasure to be here in the Kraft State, and congratulations on your on your 60th anniversary, and I love the vision for today and the future. And I'm going to try and take in a real quick dive across the future of health and medicine. I'm going to start with a little bit of art I did. I was flying out from San Francisco yesterday, and I do a little bit of art. I felt artsy, so I did that. And I made that about the future of the hospital. And I was feeling like doing some, you know, more modern-esque things. So I did that in about 3 minutes. Of course, now you don't need to be an artist. You can start to use new technologies like DALL-E, which is now open to the public. So it's a good example of technology accelerating and changing how we can do things in new ways. At this kind of super convergence of, you know, art and medicine and technology, where we really have the opportunity to sort of rethink healthcare across the whole perspective, a whole spectrum. And so what I'm going to try and cover today is about how healthcare is shifting and hopefully help you guys think about how you take that forward here and in Kentucky, and that as how healthcare is getting more digital, hopefully more intelligent, super connected, more data-driven, and that we can really make healthcare more accessible, affordable, and equitable in Kentucky and around the world. So thematically, of course, this is being enabled by the acceleration of technologies, not any one technology, but many of them. And thematically, I'm going to try and cover how about where we've been and where we might go through the convergence of new ideas, new mindsets, leadership, and innovation. About 11 years ago, I gave a TED talk about the future of medicine. I'm a bit of an accidental futurist. You know, the future of medicine, there's an app for that. That was in 2011. There were about 25,000 apps then. And the theme of that talk was how technology is getting faster, cheaper, better, and at the convergence of these fields, it gives us the opportunity to do things a bit differently. And you know, that was in the era of the iPhone, I think, 3. And so as technology has continued to converge and accelerate, we can kind of do things in sometimes almost magical ways and disrupt entire fields. We've all seen the disruption of how we get our banking is all digitized, how we get entertainment streamed, any movie, anytime, anywhere. Of course, we've all been living through this horrible COVID pandemic disruption. And you know, there is a bit of a silver lining from my perspective. It sort of opened our eyes that while many fields like digital banking and entertainment and other fields have reached the sort of fourth industrial age, healthcare is sort of stuck in the third and sometimes even the second industrial age. And that gives us the opportunity to sort of move things in different ways. And we've all experienced how COVID sort of accelerated our thinking and our ability to innovate. So who's the chief transformation officer that led our change? It was often COVID. And hopefully some of the energy and the catalyzation is going to move us forward. I love this quote from Regina Dugan, who used to run DARPA. Sputnik set off the space age, and COVID is sparking a bit of a new health age. So hopefully we can kind of take some of the positive energies forward. And so I have another TED talk 10 years after that other one about how COVID transformed the future of medicine. But we're all familiar with now it's shifted things towards telemedicine, faster vaccine development, et cetera. But it gave a bit of a lens to look 10 years back and where we were 10 years ago, where we are today, and where we might be in the next 10 years. Or in the case of this amazing organization, we might be in the next 60. So let's use that lens to look into the future. So when we think about the future, we're here, you know, celebrating the future of this amazing hospital, and we still think often about the four walls of a clinic where we do care. But of course, we're moving from hospital increasingly to homespital, and that's been accelerated by COVID, where care happens. We move to lab to laptop, how we are able to do virtual clinical trials and or Internet of Medical Things. So we virtualize some elements of care. But even though we're in this magical sort of sometimes exponential age, it still sometimes feels like we're a bit back to the future. I've had my own back to the future moments. I trained, as I mentioned, at Mass General Hospital. There I was when I was a resident 20-something years ago. When we were real residents. There weren't 80-hour workweek restrictions. And when I go back and visit MGH, I sometimes go visit the White 9 ward, where I was an intern my very first month. And I have a little PTSD when I visit, but because the same alarms are beeping, and some of the same nurses, maybe some of the same patients. The only difference is the young intern on call is now, you know, typing their note. We used to handwrite that, remember that? And the front desk, even at Mass General or my home base at Stanford, is still using the cutting edge communication tool of our day to talk to the pharmacies, like the fax machine, right? Or filling out the same paper forms. Or I had a cardiac study done at Stanford about a year ago. How did I get my results? On a CD-ROM. I don't even own a CD-ROM player anymore. So we're still sometimes stuck in some of the old architectures of the past. And it's our opportunity to sort of break through those. You know, I love this tweet. Some people say that AI will replace doctors, but I can't really hear them over the sound of my pager beeping, heavy-handed printing on carbon triplicate, and tab-tab elf-toll arachine. So we're still in today, right? And we have this opportunity to, you know, think differently, whether it's technology meets public health, so we're not still in the mask era for our next pandemic. We can think differently about, you know, waiting rooms and the silos of how healthcare is often organized, which haven't changed in eons. You know, we're not necessarily, you know, how do we reorganize our hospitals, our medical schools, our pharma companies? Because we're not, you know, just a collection of body parts anymore. We're understanding disease at its molecular and genomic and multi-omics layer. So we have this opportunity now to start to connect the dots between data and integrate that across the healthcare continuum. So part of our new thinking, I think, in Kentucky and anywhere else, is to shift from our traditional model of sick care and move to this era of true health care. And what is sick care? Of course, we're all familiar with the current model. We usually get very intermittent episodic data in the four walls of the clinic, the ICU, the ER. That intermittent episodic data tends to lead to our sort of reactive mindset. We tend to wait for the patient to show up with a heart attack or with a stroke, or in my field of oncology, with a late-stage cancer, or we wait for the pandemic to arrive. And big picture, where technology can take us is to be much more continuous with our data. That data can lead to insights that are much more personalized, enable us to be more proactive, preventative, and start to bring care arguably anywhere, anytime, hopefully at better costs with better outcomes. That's a bit of a thematic of where technology is starting to take healthcare. We can also be much more precise. You know, for the top 10 grossing drugs sold in the United States in the last couple years, they're only really effective for about 1 in 4 to 1 in 24 of the folks who take them. So we have a long way to go to this era of precision personalized medicine. And I think our goal for all of us is not just to treat disease in better ways, of course, maybe even to prevent it, but to start thinking about optimizing health and wellness, the whole new sort of shift to the left of optimizing not just lifespan, but health span. I come from California. A lot of people want to live forever. That's a long time. I think we all really want to optimize the health span component. And of course, we have some challenges there in the United States. We spend a lot of our dollars, but don't have the best outcomes compared to some of our colleagues. And we've now just dipped below China in life expectancy. So lots of challenges and opportunities. And what I'm going to try and do over the next 35 minutes or so is kind of cover that spectrum quickly. Where are we now at the cutting edge with health and prevention? And where might we go? Diagnostics, how do we move to stage zero diagnostics, not stage three? Therapy, that might be a digital therapeutic, a digiceutical, or with a drug or with a device. And a bit about discovery. How do we accelerate our new knowledge and move things to the clinic and impact faster, democratizing healthcare? So that's a bit of a theme. So the future of healthcare, medicine's been a bit in the zeitgeist, particularly during the pandemic. I was lucky to write the opening article for Nat Geo a couple years ago. And the theme of this is actually wasn't about 12 innovations, but how innovations are coming together and that they're often accelerating, and we need to understand that acceleration if we're going to try and build this future. So just to remind you about exponentials, our brains are pretty good at thinking linearly. 30 linear steps, I'll be across the lobby. That's 30 steps, 30 meters. But if I kept exponentially stepping, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, by the 30th step, I'm at a billion. That would be 26 times around the planet. That's sometimes a bit surprising to our brains to kind of grok that. And so you need to sort of keep that in mind, because many technologies on this exponential kind of surprise us. You know, we're all familiar with Moore's Law, which has given us the supercomputers in our pocket. And of course, you know, that's shrinking, you know, the price of transistors and data is getting faster and cheaper. Soon we're going to see the advent of quantum computing, which is going to play a huge role in managing our digital biomarkers and drug discovery. So the world is accelerating. And that gives us this lens to, you know, change our thinking about how we address the healthcare continuum. Now, the classic example, of course, is still my smartphone, which is lost in my pocket. I still have my old iPhone 2 from 2008 or so. You know, remember when Michael Douglas talked on the beach 30 years ago on the Wall Street movie? That was kind of a shift in people's perspective. And of course, that was for the super rich. Now, of course, we all have these computers in our pocket. My iPhone 13 is now already out of date. And soon, of course, these are going to dissolve into our augmented reality glasses that keep rumored to come out from Apple in the next year or so, or contact lenses, which are on coming through clearance, which will give us a new way to look at the world, including in the biomedical sphere. So we can start to take our sort of exponential medicalized smartphone in even surprising ways, because it's not just for telemedicine and talking and doing a FaceTime visit. We now have a ton of sort of sensors on there we can use in pretty unique ways. And just a couple of interesting examples. For example, modifying the speaker and the microphone. You can look in your kid's ear and detect otitis media, or pick up someone's facial expressions for pain, or leverage the smartphone camera to look at wound care to enable the nurse, the patient, the caregiver to manage wounds in more unique ways and take that in the outpatient realm. So on this exponential trend, of course, what used to fit on our desktop now fits on our
watch, which I think is FDA cleared for certain elements, including AFib, or now detecting falls or changes in gait. And you know, this gives us the opportunity to reimagine what's possible today and what's coming in the next 5 and 10 years across that kind of whole care continuum, from hopefully before an event to diagnostics, planning, therapy, recovery, monitoring, and even the public health elements. So a lot of this new change, of course, is in this now digital realm, enabled by Moore's Law. What used to be, you know, physical, like a GPS unit or a video camera, of course, is dissolved into an app. It's basically become dematerialized. It means it's also sometimes free, demonetized, and can be democratized. A lot of, we'll talk about access and equity. It means some of these tools can become quite powerful and be in almost anybody's pocket with a smartphone. So our challenge is not to underestimate the possible. This great quote from Bill Gates, most people overestimate what they can do in 1 year and not underestimate what they can do in 10 years. And I think the next 10 years will make the last 10 years look kind of slow. So what's some examples of what's coming and shifting? Part of the shift is what is enabling our consumers, our humans, our patients, our community members. Each of us now can compare one hospital down the street to another. There's Yelp for doctors, like vitals.com. There's GoodRx, which enables you to find pharmacy prices. Like, the power of the consumer leveraging data is quite interesting. Even looking at data from individual surgeons and scoring them and understanding who's the best surgeon for your knee replacement with the least complication rate. So data can empower the consumer and shift how and where we get care. And a lot of this information, of course, is riding not just the Internet of Things, but the Internet of Medical Things. We're now in an era of trillions of connected devices, riding 5G, soon 6G. And of course, all these new devices create tons of data, which we all know is often siloed in electronic medical records that don't talk to each other, in our EMRs, in our billing, and our genomics information. So we don't want just data, right? We want to go from data to actual information, insights. You know, that you've heard that quote about 17 years from something being published to something that becomes useful at the clinic. So we need to sort of move from data to insights and narrow that gap. And of course, COVID did accelerate some of our learning in terms of narrowing the gap and managing patients in the ICU with COVID, for example. So big picture, data's fine, it may be the new oil, but it's the insights and the actionability that's important. And of course, how we communicate that. We've all experienced the impact of the infodemic when information is bumbled or miscommunicated or used nefariously. So while technology, of course, is great, it's not what really drives, as we know, changes in healthcare. It's the technology merging with our incentives. And of course, we still predominantly treat and manage with the sick care equation on the right side of the equation, fee for service. And we're starting to see the value chain move a bit to the left to rewarding wellness and prevention, not just for the new stent and the procedure, et cetera. And so you all know that outcomes are the new incomes, and that challenging shift to value-based care aligning with technology is where things start to get interesting. And of course, some of those incentives are to change where care happens, from hospital to home, to our phone, to on, and even inside our bodies. And that provides some interesting shifts and some dynamics, right? We're seeing the MinuteClinics and the CVSs and the Walmarts try to battle it out to do primary care. And some people live much closer to a Walmart than they do to a hospital or a clinic. We've seen telemedicine, we'll talk more about that, of course, play a role in that as well. So, you know, it's interesting, new players coming in which are providing veterinary care, mental health, and eye care all in one center. Or we'll start to see the convergence of virtual exams with diagnostics and labs all in a pod in very remote rural areas as well as for global health. So things are shifting, and that means it's an era of more mobile, connected, or often what's called digital health, right? So digital health is a bit of a buzzword. I think about digital health as this ability now to connect the dots between all these forms of data and make it actionable, useful to the patient, the clinician, the community, the healthcare system, the hospital administrator. And, you know, it used to be a buzzword, but now it's being explored. There's lots of digital health centers, from UCSF to Stanford to centers at the FDA. There's journals that exploded in the space. So it gives us this new lens to see data and the insights and make use of it. There's now, you know, digital therapeutics, FDA-cleared devices and software and apps. And, of course, now we have 300,000+ apps. Many of them are not FDA-cleared and aren't purely medical. So we're going to see a little bit of convergence because we can't have an app for every condition or a different wearable for every element. We kind of want the one ring and the one app to rule them all. I think a lot of consolidation is going to start to come together in the next decade. So again, thematically, while digital is moving quickly, it's only the rails of which many other technologies ride, from AR and 3D printing and nanotech and synthetic biology and virtual reality and blockchain. All these accelerating technologies are, again, super converging and give us this opportunity to create often entire new fields. I mean, what's in the middle there didn't exist when I was a Stanford medical student, right? Robotic surgery, telemedicine in its form, AI meets radiology, companion diagnostics, computational biology. These are all pretty new fields. You know, CRISPR, all those elements are now giving us new tools to address the challenges we have in healthcare. And it's great to see the ARPA-H hopefully being launched now to kind of give a DARPA-like ability to take these technologies, invent new ones, and move them for prevention, treatment, and cure. So these new tools, again, give us the mindset and the ability to address grand challenges. We all know the challenges: rising costs, aging populations, challenge with access, challenges with managing the data and repeating tests and fax machine elements. And of course, even our regulatory challenges, we'll be hearing from the head of the FDA, that they have to, they're getting on board with us, of course, as well. And of course, the payers, who often have the hammer on what innovations get paid for. So lots of challenges, but lots of opportunities. I've been through the pandemic chairing this XPRIZE Pandemic and Health Alliance, and part of the theme is that these new solutions come from multiple players. You can't just have the usual sources. It's often the small startups, the academics, the Fortune 50s, medical and non-medical folks collaborating. That's what we did through the pandemic to address PPE and diagnostics and therapy and mental health. So it's been fun to be at this convergence point. Now, just a reminder, of course, that technology is great, but most of our outcomes are driven more by our social determinants, and we've all seen the impacts of disparities, particularly through the pandemic, in terms of who's had mortality and morbidity. We've seen the disparities based on zip code, and so we need to pay attention to the technology piece with a social determinants element, right? If your friends are obese or healthy or exercise, you're more likely to be obese or to exercise. So thinking about the social elements, not just the determinants of health, to thinking about the pandemic of obesity as well. And putting on my pediatrician hat, what are some simple things we can do early in life, right? We know if we give a child not the white rice seal, but solid, more whole grain elements when they start to eat at 6 months of age, it changes their metabolome, their gut microbiome, and their epigenetics, and they have much lower likelihood of obesity and diabetes downstream. So many early things we can do to impact things in big ways. So again, paying attention to the core elements of our physiologic needs, food deserts, access to food, sleep, water, vaccinations, and our new digital determinants of health. Do we have access to internet connectivity? Or my favorite, still thing hasn't been solved for, battery life. We need to solve for that one. That's a big challenge. And so you need to think about the digital determinants. Does your patient have a digital plan? Do they have high-speed internet? And of course, many parts of Kentucky, California, Rwanda don't have good internet connectivity, but as we're seeing available in Ukraine from Starlink, we're going to start to see that democratize around the US and the world. So whole new worlds are going to open up with high-speed access through our mobile and other devices. Now, back to the art of the possible, right? We now are in this exponential age. We need to be thinking exponentially and connecting those dots. I mean, Uber's only been around, what, 10, 11 years? They're an example of an exponential company. They didn't invent the smartphone, GPS, online payments. They kind of connect the dots, enable it to be easier to get around, right? They're even now getting into healthcare, Uber and Lyft. They'll bring patients to the clinic or nurses to deliver vaccines. And of course, this Uberization has some interesting applications. And human Uber, developed in Japan, provides a way to attend events remotely using another person's body. It's surprisingly natural. So maybe you'll come to your next meeting with your human Uber. That's a bit of an extreme. But we've seen this ability now to have better user interfaces, to press a button and get a doctor or nurse to sometimes visit you or deliver your drugs. We've seen big tech, as we could talk more about, get into the space in all sorts of interesting ways with all their sort of consumer know-how. Amazon, which has not yet fully fulfilled their promise, Amazon Care is being rewound, is of course already in the pharmacy space, doing pill pack and disruptive to our friends in the standard pharmacy realm. I used to joke about them delivering drugs and other things by drone, but as of earlier this year, the FAA has now approved the first drone-based delivery for drugs, vaccines, and blood products. And we've even seen drones do some surprising things in Africa, delivering blood products, for example, or the first defibrillator delivered and saving a patient's life in the setting of a myocardial infarction. So surprising advancements of drones for hopefully the good side. There's also a dark side, if you've seen recently with drones. So we need to see, you know, how this is disrupting across biomedicine. Pharma, you know, the one-size-fits-all drug is not going to be the norm. It's changing the world of, you know, cancer vaccines may hopefully disrupt our need for oncology drugs. The payer world, how we interact with our insurance companies, can hopefully will be a little more interactive and have smarter user interfaces as well. And so, of course, there's many examples of entire industries being disrupted. No one goes to Blockbuster anymore. No one uses Kodak film anymore. And Kodak, of course, you probably know the story, invented digital photography but didn't want to cut into their film sales. And what happened is digital photography got exponentially better. They went bankrupt the same year Instagram was built by 12 kids down the street from me in Palo Alto and sold for $1 billion. So you want to be the disruptor, not the disruptee. You essentially want to be Ubering yourself before you get Kodak, as a summary. Just think about how do you Uber yourself to get not Kodak in healthcare, which is always a challenge. And not just to think about Moore's Law. Moore's Law is great, but Amara's Law. Sometimes we get overexcited. Remember IBM Watson? It was going to bring AI doctors. That was in 2011. So we sometimes overestimate what might happen in the short run and underestimate what might happen in a 10-year run. Now we're seeing AI meet radiology and pathology and dermatology and pharma and new drugs in exciting ways. So we sometimes don't want to underestimate what's possible in the next decade. Here's an example. Sometimes things start a little bit kludgy. I was in the Dubai airport a few months ago and I took this video of this drunk-looking suitcase following this guy. It seemed to have a few problems, maybe a little inebriated, bumping into things. So not perfect. But imagine 10 years from now, your drone will be carrying your suitcase for you behind you. So the art of the possible is coming. I've been sort of at this interesting interface. I've been the chair of medicine for something called Singularity University. I've run a big program for 10 years called Exponential Medicine. We bring folks from 40 countries in almost every field of medicine and technology together to kind of be at the interface, to cross-connect, to see what's cutting edge and what's coming next. And we were very lucky for several years to actually have several folks from the FDA come. I love this quote saved by Tony Young, the head of innovation from NHS. This is an old quote he shared. The difficulty lies not in the new ideas, but in escaping from the old ones. So I would challenge you to think about what old ideas might be holding you back in the field of biomedical innovation. How do we bring the regulators along? We were lucky to have Bakul Patel at the time was heading up digital health, digital at FDA, and looked at what was coming, and that helped the FDA develop the software as a medical device, and the pre-check and pre-cert programs, and the new platforms for digital health. So you need to bring all players together if we're going to enable some of these technologies to succeed. And we're now rebooting exponential medicine, something called Next Med Health. Hopefully some of you can join us in San Diego this March. Okay, let's look quickly at three key areas: prevention, diagnostics, therapy, and where care and how it's happening and how those are shifting. Let's start with sort of health and prevention, right? In Kentucky, you've got a lot of issues with folks who don't even have the best behaviors. That's a global issue. While our genetics are important, we know our behaviors drive most of our bad outcomes, especially our lack of sleep, which I have right now, stress, smoking, bad diet. And now we're just in an era where we can start to measure our behaviors. 17 years ago, I did a project with NASA. We built this black box for the body for astronauts. Now that, of course, fits on your wristwatch as a Fitbit. Fitbit only launched 12, 13 years ago. And we're in the beginning stages of being able to measure folks' physiology anytime, anywhere. I'm wearing five different wearables right now. I'm curious, how many of you have a wearable on right now? Just curious in the room. How many of you ever used one with a patient? 1%, 2%. This just came out, translational gaps and opportunities for medical wearables and digital health. Huge opportunity, because these sort of wearables and otherables are going well beyond what fits on your wristwatch or even sensors that could go on a pill. They're really becoming a power to enable and measure almost every element of physiology and behavior. You can have self-powered ones that are powered by body movement. We can see even simple wearables. They don't need to be FDA cleared. A Fitbit, for example, when you send a patient home from a COVID admission or a total hip replacement, are they walking more as you might expect and doing great? Or are they walking less? If they're walking less, maybe there's something going on. You need to intervene before they have a fall or the readmission. That's simple, small data. We can take the small data from our mobile devices and pick up issues around mental health and cognition and neurologic diseases from how we type and how we interact with our digital devices. And because so many of our patients now have some sort of wearable, we can think about how we might integrate that into care, right? This idea of now remote patient management is becoming integrated into keeping people out of the hospital or the hospital at home. And the big picture, we're kind of moving from quantified self, a lot of us are data geeks, we have our data on our phone, to quantified health. The next decade, we'll see our digital exhaust start to integrate with our care providers to enable us to measure and optimize wellness, prevention, public health, to diagnose diseases early based on our digital biomarkers, and to manage treatment, whether it's for diabetes, cancer, heart disease, in much more data feedback-driven manners. So a few examples that have been digitized. You know the scale's been digital for a while, but here's a fun one. This is the shape scale. Whether you like it or not, it gives you your weight and your shape and your muscle mass and fat mass. That might be super useful in a bunch of modalities for your home exam or even in the clinic. Blood pressure, of course, can now fit on a wristband on your watch, but no one's squeezing on your wrist. Now we're seeing radar-based versions and patches, which have now gotten FDA clearance, which I think we'll see in the next generation Apple Watches and beyond, that will do real-time continuous blood pressure, maybe even blood sugar on our wearables. So that's going to be a big game changer. And now there are patches that are on the market, which basically do blood pressure, SU, all these 16 different biomarkers. I won't read them all out, giving you an intensive care unit level of data from a simple patch that will stream for a month anywhere you have connectivity. So lots of new data. The challenge again is how we use it. We can put not just wearables on your wrist, but wearables on your shoes. We can think about insidables, technologies that are getting so small they can go into a contact lens or underneath your skin or into a suture. These are going to be new modalities that will not just enable us to track one biomarker, but many, and starts with the DARPA and the soldier of the future, but we'll start to monitor some of our chronic disease patients with this sort of information. Then this idea of a trainable, right? We're all hunched over our phones too much or our smart laptops. I love this little technology out of Israel invented by some fighter pilots there. You put this little sensor on your back. It's kind of like your digital mother. It kind of knows when you're hunched over for too long, and it tracks your posture. And when you're hunched over for a bit, depending on how you set it, it gives you a little buzz. And it's like, Daniel, stand up straight. About a week of wearing that, my posture is much better. And that has lots of applications for lower back pain. So not just measuring data, but giving you feedback. There's shockables. Those will change behavior. Hearables, ringables. I think many of you have seen the Aura Ring or similar technologies. Think about all the technology that fits on my ring now that gives lots of interesting insights. I can track my sleep. I can track my sleep, my temperature. It can predict not just, and by the way, if you do nothing else with you or your patients, start to track your sleep and try to optimize that. It has such a role across so many other elements, and there's some clever ways to get sleep at work if you need downtime. But of course, the Aura Ring now can even pick up pregnancy, I think 6 days before home pregnancy test. They did a study with UCSF, and they could predict your titer after a COVID vaccine based on changes in temperature, heart rate variability, and respiratory rate. So lots of new data can come from our consumer devices. There's also breathables, right? You can track the quality of your breath before you go on a date, but you can also start to use these as nanonoses to pick up metabolic disease and cancers. We're in the era of ingestibles, pills that will track your gut health and even manage and pick up your microbiome. Sweatables that could be used for athletes or patients with heart failure or renal disease. Sockables for diabetics who can't feel their feet to find hot spots before they might have an ulcer or need an amputation. Wearables for pain. Wearables for shakeables that can track your tremor and optimize your medication dosage. Or even this idea of electroceuticals that are now coming to market. So a patient with essential tremor, she can't even write straight, puts on this wearable device from a Stanford spin-out called Califf, and it measures the tremor and kind of negates it out, kind of like noise reduction headset. You turn it on, and now her tremor is turned off, and that's being used for essential tremor in Parkinson's. A good example of a wearable, again, that provides more than just data. Then these things are getting so cheap that they're even in your underwear. I call them underwearables. This company started as a sensor for tracking stress and meditation, but now the CPT codes have changed, and you have incentives to use these devices to track home-based COPD and other respiratory issues. So you get a pack of 10 of these, put them in every pair of your underwear, and you're automatically sensored. So that's a great example. Censored. Canes, new ways to make wheelchairs enabled, even starting to enable with wearables essentially an exoskeleton for someone who's paraplegic. Those have been around for a while, but there are now newer ones. I got to try wearing one in Europe this summer. It's 3D printed, it's AI controlled. In about 3 minutes, I got my hang of it. It was a little strange to be walked around by a robot, but really has the ability to enable disabled. And new versions of these are starting to start to enable folks with just muscle weakness or stroke and help with rehab. Or even folks at Huer have made next generation bionic elements. They're now developing these for normally abled folks to enable them to walk faster, sort of bionic boots, exoboots. So those are going to be part of our wearable future. Since I'm a pilot, I love my ultimate wearable is the jet suit. These are already being used in Switzerland to help rescue people in high mountain spots, which are hard to get to. I get a chance to fly the jet suit. Here's my best flights, looking like James Bond. Most of the time, I wasn't doing quite as well. Most of the time, I wasn't doing this. I was more looking like most of the time like this. So not quite as fun, but the ultimate wearable, right? Okay. And then, of course, we can start to measure and quantify our most important drug. Food is medicine, or medicine is food. We can start to measure our inputs. Lots of apps now can track what meal you've taken, and with AI can sensor and pick up exactly what meal and how many calories. Does it have gluten or peanuts or other things in it? So we can measure input in AI-assisted ways, and that's helpful. But we can now start to measure not just ins, but also outs. Not just in the inpatient setting. There's a lot of now, no kidding, I use like 5 or 6 companies, including Toto, making home-based health-related toilets with, you can imagine the possibilities there. There's now in the era of, measuring your metabolomics, right? Not for just diabetics. I can look at how I respond to different meals. And of course, you know all the fad diets out there. The future is going to be precision nutrition, using your microbiome, your genome, your metabolome to really optimize diets for prevention and therapy going forward. Now, we're also now past the era of wearing anything. We're in the era of invisibles. The camera on your smartphone or laptop can pick up blood pressure, heart rate, O2 sat, respiratory rate. So we're going to start to be measuring our biomarkers in many easy, seamless ways. Cameras might be a bit intrusive, but they can tell for aging in place. Is that family or a couple upright? Are they dressed? Are they behaving normally? Voice is another invisible biomarker that's really getting exciting. It can pick up changes in neurologic health, changes of Parkinson's, mental health issues. We're now seeing this idea of acoustic epidemiology. So if you cough, it can kind of tell who you are, how old you are. Do you have TB, or do you have croup, or do you have pertussis? And this idea of, coughalytics. There's a company out of Australia just bought by Pfizer, $120 million, called Respiratory Something. And it's an example of, this moving pretty quickly to be a diagnostic tool. And then our connected homes. Wi-Fi can be modified to measure the vital signs and pick up the vitals of 10 or more people in the same house, in the same room. So what do we do with all this connected data? Sometimes we can use it to have insights about who's developing a disease early, like early examples of picking up Parkinson's using multiple signals and AI and digital exhaust. So whether we like it or not, our digital exhaust is being collected. What do we do with it? Who owns it? How do we control it? How do we optimize it? Right? Is it the big players? How do we empower the individual to use this data? Sometimes it might change our insurance plans if we walk our 10,000 steps a day. And of course, people will try and hack that kind of thing if you get an incentive to walk 10,000 steps. People pay me to put steps in their Fitbits, which might be a clever idea, but you can tell, like your fingerprint, who's wearing a wearable, and if you're changing in gait, if you like to have a fall. So your wearable is almost like a fingerprint. And then, of course, all this data, again, can be overwhelming to clinicians. We don't want more data. What is it, doc? Just as I thought, you're generating too much data. No clinician wants the data, right? You don't want to log in 10 different apps and wearables. We need to synthesize this in powerful ways and align it with our workflows and align it with our incentives. And we're starting to see some examples of that to hopefully address burnout. I mean, you've probably heard about the triple aim. We now need the quadruple aim, improving, using technology and design to improve the clinician experience. And it's starting to come together. With platforms like Apple Health now, you can share your data with your friends, your family, your physician. And companies like Verily are now doing studies, integrating thousands of patients, sharing their digital biomarkers, their lab data, their medical record data, so we make sense of all these new, not just wearable, but other information in the real world. Or the NIH doing the All of Us trial. I'm a data donor for that. 1 million Americans sharing genome, lab data, medical record data, and now it's starting to become impactful. I mean, think about how much we are dependent on Framingham studies based on a small population of European Caucasian nurses from Western Massachusetts. Now these can be much more democratized. So that will bring us to this era of predictalytics. Like, we're going to have a bit of an integrated FICO score for our health, or we're going to have a bit of a check engine light that shows up for our patient before they end up having the blowing their gasket and having an issue. And I used to talk about the check engine light, but one of my colleagues at Stanford, Mike Snyder, has been building that. He's the most censored guy on the planet. He picked up his diabetes and his Lyme disease probably months before he would have picked it up otherwise. And a recent study they did showed how the Apple Watch could detect who has COVID a couple days before you're symptomatic. You can imagine the implications of that. So this check engine light is not just the future. And so you can track your data now on your Apple Watch. This is my data I can track for years now my data. And what my baseline is and when it changes is what's interesting, right? So, imagine you're getting your text from your doc who's looking at your AI doc is sifting through your data and gives you a little note saying you need to be seen based on changes in your resting heart rate, for example. So we can also leverage this for public health. We can crowdsource temperatures on platforms like Kinsa and know what's happening in your exact area code or neighborhood. You can leverage social network information and know who's been sick around you, and that leads to interesting implications. Before you walk into a room and see somebody, you understand who to fist bump or who to shake hands with or stay around with. I think Mark's okay. Yeah, Rob's fine. Mark, I'm not so sure about. So it's just an example of this dystopian future that will come with too much data. And so this minority report element might come here, not just for infectious disease, but other diseases as well. Now, the challenge is we have all this data and even insights, but that doesn't change behavior very well. We know that's our biggest challenge, and we now have some new modalities to start shifting behavior, the smart avatar, the coach that often can be a robot for some, or an avatar, or really integrate and match the patient's needs. Because the new drug is the empowered patient, but they're not one size fits all. We want not just precision medicine, but precision interfaces. And so when you're thinking about designing or developing new platforms, design thinking is key. Are you dealing with a millennial who wants to just Snapchat with their doctor, or the baby boomer who still needs the hand on the shoulder? So you can't be one size fits all. And we're starting to see examples of, Apple-like clinics like Forward, or avatars that are looking so real that you can't tell they're not humans. And those can be coaches and help people change behavior. And in terms of hospital to home, and voice can be, of course, a biomarker as well as a way to communicate in the ER, the ICU, or the home environment. Many examples of, Alexa, I've fallen, I can't get up, or what medication dosage should I use? Or voice with natural language processing, writing your clinical notes for you so you don't have to type them into Epic. That's evolving across several platforms. And so this is coming together in interesting ways. We'll each soon in the next decade have our kind of own personal health coach, which gives us information maybe in the way we digest it with a personal health score. It shows us you of today, or maybe you of tomorrow. You of tomorrow if you're doing your Peloton, your P90X, or you of tomorrow if you keep having Dunkin' Donuts for breakfast. You of tomorrow, right? And I can see myself now and 100 Dunkin' Donuts later, and I only have one Dunkin' Donut. I love Dunkin' Donuts. Or if you have a patient who smokes, you can show them, before smoking, and after smoking using, augmented reality, or what happens if you spend too much time on social media, which is another challenge. So this is kind of one of my favorite areas of integrated lessons, augmented virtual reality. I'm gonna skip this video. Okay, so how do we put this together and make it useful in the clinic? I still have my antique Google Glass. They weren't a great hit in terms of consumer use, but they have all sorts of applications in the clinic. Of course, augmented reality is now enabling clinicians of all sorts to pull complex data together. Augmented reality can start to enable surgeons to see through the body and do surgery step by step. It's enabling us to communicate with our patients and show them inside their bodies and help them understand physiology. Here's my augmented reality t-shirt, which is great to use with kids especially. Here's my son Leo with his augmented reality shirt. He knows a bit more about his physiology at age 3 than he would otherwise. That can engage him for life and in health. And then, of course, these technologies start a bit kludgy, but they're getting integrated into our normal-looking glasses. And I love flying again, so I love examples from aviation, checklists, crew resource management, but they also have the idea that we'll start to look at our environments in new ways, just like the heads-up display in the fighter cockpit gives us the ability, and I was a flight surgeon in the Air National Guard, so I spent lots of time with fighter jets. It will warn us if a bad guy's shooting at you or you're about to hit a mountain, it'll talk to you too, right? Tell you to pull up. So imagine we use that for behavior change. You'll see your meal in one way, then maybe a bit of another way, and it'll give you a little nudge before you have that breakfast, So fun changes. And then, of course, there's virtual reality. I hope you've all tried VR. It's fun to put grandma on a roller coaster. It feels real, but virtual reality is becoming a true tool. It can be used to treat pain patients. They use like less than half of the opiates and burn patients that go into VR environments. It's being used with PTSD and virtual reality to address mental health issues. It's being used in physical therapy. No one does their physical therapy. Now you can gamify it and track it in fun ways. We can take patients who are in the hospital and stuck in a bone marrow transplant unit, or going to an operating room, and they go to the beach and they use less opiates and have better outcomes just by being in VR. It can be used, of course, for exercise. Like I spent 100 days doing VR workouts, and early in the pandemic, you see my resting heart rate went down by like 10 points. So lots of ways VR is useful, but it's going to be a game changer, and it's starting to begin medical education. You've got a great medical school here. It's going to hopefully change how we learn about, tetralogy flow. I can never remember that, but now I can walk inside a heart and see it and touch it and look at the physiology and the intervention. I don't need to peer over the shoulder of the surgeon. I can be live streaming a surgery to, medical students around the world to enhance medical education. We can do coaching. And this is a platform called Proximy, where a master surgeon could be coaching a surgeon around the world in very difficult or normal circumstances and improving outcomes in that sort of way. And of course, we can simulate anything today. Anything is simulated, but it gets really interesting when we do VR, right? And I think if you're an orthopedic, if you haven't practiced taking out a nail, you can practice it like a pilot practices on a flight simulator. And of course, now instead of practicing the patient, you practice, instead of see one, do one, teach one, you see one and you sim one, you sim one and sim one until you get it right. And that's gonna be part of the future of medical education in all sorts of fields. And the outcomes and the learnings from these are better maintained. Okay. So how do we synthesize all that to really improve outcomes? What if we could build a bit of a ways for surgeons, right? Because, not here, of course, but 50% of doctors are below average. I hate to break it to you. So we could use some help in our decision-making. How do we learn the lessons from thousands of other surgeons and start to integrate that into our care as we go forward? It's like I drove a Tesla here because my plane was delayed till this morning, so I drove 6 hours. Half of it was, you know, with quasi-autonomous driving. That's going to start to autonomize some elements of care. And robots, of course, are today driven by the surgeon, but they're becoming more autonomous. You can now do robotics to draw blood, so the phlebotomist might be in trouble. We're seeing it for doing anastomoses, and Hopkins showed the first example of a fully autonomous laparoscopic surgery earlier this year. So, you know, the ability to have an avatar in a robot is still a bit kludgy. I got to drive one of these. I'm on the right there driving it, and there's a robot on the left. These will get more and more supplanted with AI and machine learning. I'm gonna try and finish in 5 minutes. Sorry, I'm going late. Let's switch to two other things quickly in this last 5 minutes. Diagnostics and therapy. Of course, diagnostics is key to healthcare. We have a lot of new ways to pick up diseases early, like dementia, based on not just brain scans, but blood biomarkers, genetics, eye tracking on a video game. And that, I mean, we start to treat dementia years before you have symptoms, like a cholesterol, like a statin for high cholesterol, but for the brain. And imaging, of course, is on the exponential. Here's my own brain, it comes color-coded with AI. The scanners are getting cheaper, more available. Many of us are getting full-body MRIs, still too expensive, but we'll get democratized. I think 10 years from now, you'll go to your corner pharmacy and could get a full-body scan in 10 minutes read by the AI radiologist. The scanners are getting smaller and mobile. This is the example of the Hyperfine that just came to market. I had my own brain MRI on a boat on the Hudson in 5 minutes plugged into wall power. So that can democratize diagnostics. And there are even wearable versions of these coming to market that will pick up tumors and infarcts and beyond. And of course, now each of us doesn't need to go to the clinic to do diagnostics. We have this sort of digital doctor's bag. 10 years ago, the first examples of diagnostics were plugging into your smartphone. Our friend Dave Albert had the first versions of an EKG. Now you go on CNN, you see ads for a live core to do a 6-lead EKG, and you can even put one on a credit card. So we're seeing this convergence of diagnostics being democratized. So this is a bit of my personal digital doctor's bag. The TytoCare elements that you can buy in a Best Buy can enable telemedicine. The stethoscope, I was never good at listening to heart sounds, now has AI and EKGs built in and enables you to basically diagnose a heart murmur. Or, you know, we're not going to have stethoscopes pretty soon because now there are what replaces the $200,000 ultrasound, the $2,000. So maybe you probably have the butterfly ultrasound, which can, with some AI assistance, bring democratized diagnostics anywhere around the planet. And that has a tremendous power to upskill almost anybody to be a good ulcer sonographer or cardiologist. And of course, the laboratory is getting on the chip. You don't need to have a whole central lab now. We can now put that, in some cases, on a smartphone. I led a $10 million XPRIZE for rapid, fast, frequent, cheap, and easy COVID testing early in the pandemic. We had 700 teams from 70 countries, and pretty amazing winners came out of it, everything from using smell to breath as biomarkers. And those won't just be good for COVID, but other infectious and non-infectious diseases. And now we've all experienced home diagnostics. That's going to be a game changer. Or the medical selfie. I'm on the board of this Israeli company called Healthy.io. Instead of bringing you to your patient to the lab to do a urine analysis to screen for UTI or preeclampsia or early kidney disease, you can just dip the urine dipping stone, take a picture with a camera, and boom, you get the urine analysis results right away. And that just got FDA cleared, thankfully, in the US and has had big impacts for picking up early kidney disease to save folks' kidneys, for example. And then, of course, in cancer, the cancer moonshot's being rebooted, and now the ability to do blood-based biomarkers or blood-based biopsies for early cancer detection is getting pretty exciting. Now, a lot of this, of course, rides the exponentials around our genome. Sequencing, of course, has dropped from about $10,000 10 years ago to about, arguably, $300, maybe in the next few years, less than the cost of a CBC. How do we use this today? We're not even using pharmacogenomics today. We have the opportunity to plug that into our healthcare systems to improve picking the right statin, for example. We have the challenges of understanding diseases at their genetic level. It's not just type 2 diabetes. There's at least 3 genetic subtypes or even more. And so we're going to start to use genomics, polygenic risk scores to really start to risk stratify folks and manage them in much smarter ways that will be integrated into our medical records and our care paradigms. And of course, the databases are becoming more democratized and demonstrable, not just from European Caucasians as well. So beyond the genome, we have the proteome, the exposome, the microbiome. We know that the role of the microbiome. How much time do I have left? Should I finish in 5 minutes? Two. All right. Microbiome. Microbiome is getting interesting. I'm going to skip through the microbiome. I'm going to start to go, how do we connect the dots, right? All this data is overwhelming. AI has a role to play in letting us develop new drugs, do better dermatology, pathology. All those things are becoming somewhat AI-driven. Even GI exams are being enabled by AI to improve finding lesions. We'll start to surf the data of our ICU and pick up sepsis early, for example. We're going to start to build the digital twins. The next decade will be this era of the digital twin. We're going to mash all this data up to make it super useful. And of course, none of this replaces the doctor, the nurse, the pharmacist. It's not, you know, competition, but those of us using AI, machine learning, are going to start replacing those who don't. So see about it as a cooperation, not a competition. I'm going to skip through therapy. There's a lot going on in therapy. Virtual visits will start to be supplanted, not just the being on the screen, but talking to the chat bot ahead of time. Mental health is being augmented in all sorts of new ways. We can talk to the virtual psychologist. Avatars are coming, this new metaverse. We've heard about the metaverse, but the metaverse, where our future clinical visits won't just be on a screen, but will feel real and integrated using some of these new tools. So how do we train the clinicians of the future, not just to have good bedside manner, but good website? And I'll kind of close with, how do we put this all together? You know, now we do have digital therapeutics. Some of them are FDA-cleared apps for treating ADHD, others for mental health. There's so many solutions out there already today. How do we make sense of them? So I've recently built a new platform called digital.health. That's the domain. You can all go there. It's an easy-to-find website, which now has almost 2,000 different solutions on there. So you're looking for diagnostics. You might find the AliveCor device. You can read about its evidence base. You can put it in your own personal formulary or put it in a digital prescription pad to prescribe to a patient, as an example. You might be looking for tools around diabetes and understanding what's available in therapeutic interventions that leverage diet and find things like Virta, which can, with diet and coaching, reverse heart disease. Lots of things out there, so you try and use that to find the thousands of solutions that already exist and start to connect the dots. I'm going to skip 3D printing just to mention that we can 3D print organs, but now we'll just use CRISPRized human organs from pigs. And I'll just show you the one example of a 3D printing technology I've been developing to address the pain point of polypharmacy and poor adherence. We know all those challenges. What if we could really pick the right drug and dose instead of taking a pile of pills, 3D print your personalized polypill? So I've developed a little new printer, which enables you to print your personalized polypill, starting with generics, starting with your statin, aspirin, beta blockers, synthroid, common cardiovascular, diabetic meds, and print them maybe initially at your corner pharmacy, but eventually in your home to up your Lasix dose, change your blood thinner, etc. And that might be this future of data-driven, integrative, essentially automated compounding. And hopefully, the FDA will help us get that through. So that's one way we see the future of medicine. So I'll close with the idea of discovery. All this is very exciting. But unless we can accelerate clinical trials, you know, the new innovations don't prove themselves out and don't get into our hands. So virtualized clinical trials here, many of us have participated in those. We can now start to build, just like we crowdsource our driving, you know, a map of Rome can be built by drivers in a day. We can Wazeify and Google Mapify, I think, some elements of our health information to learn from other data donors on their own health pathways. And I used to talk about this Waze for Health, and I met one of the founders of Waze, who's actually built a Waze for Health called Stuff That Works. They're crowdsourcing real-world patients, millions of patients now, and it's a great platform to start to understand what's working and not working. So I'll close with this chart that I built with Dr. Califf at the NIH at a workshop probably 10 years ago, that the future, again, is not any one technology, but this convergence of many fields coming together. So you need to pay attention to many of them and at their interface. You don't want to think about just the technology of today in 2022, but be like Wayne Gretzky, skate to where the puck is going to be in 2025 and 2032 in the next 60 years. And if we have that exponential convergent mindset, we can go where we are from now, an episodic, physical, one-size-fits-all sick care, to a future that's much more personalized, much more continuous, much more data and intelligent-driven, crowdsourced, AI-enhanced, aligned with incentives and workflow to really democratize healthcare around the planet. So let's not take incremental steps. Let's start to take exponential ones. The future is already here. Many of you are building it. So let's not just predict it. Let's build that future boldly together and bring the what's next faster. So with that, thank you for your time and attention. Real honor and pleasure to be here. Thanks. I'll go this way.
So thank you, Dr. Kraft.
It is, it's excellent to be able to bring, again, bring world-class presenters here to talk about the different things that we're trying to do. And it's my pleasure. What we're going to do is we're going to do a question, a little bit of a question and answer at the end. So we're going to jump on into our next presentation. Our next presenter is Dr. Robert Califf. He was confirmed earlier this year as the 25th Commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration. This is his second time around. He's also was the 22nd Commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration. He has a long and distinguished career as a physician, researcher, and teacher in the fields of science and medicine. If we look at, you know, his work, he, again, went to medical school at Duke. We won't hold that against him. You know, he went to, did his residency at UCSF and then his fellowship back at Duke. I will say that he is, again, a great individual that I have had the opportunity to work with over time. These are some of the articles that we published together. He once accused me in a trial of turning chicken excrement into chicken salad, as far as the data analysis that I did as a part of the thing. So I've loved working with Rob. He also was the individual that did the foreword on one of my first perioperative medicine textbooks. He's going to talk today on a challenging subject, talking about accountability for improving the U.S. performance in health outcomes, evidence generation, and combating misinformation as key strategic imperatives. Dr. Califf.
Thanks so much, Mark. And following... Are we in good shape here?
We're going to get you.
That's quite a setup. Very nice. You know, following Daniel, it reminds me of being FDA commissioner in 2015, 2016, following Francis Collins. Francis, you know, a guitar strumming, evangelical, out in front of Congress saying at the NIH, we're going to cure cancer, we're going to cure heart disease, if only we can get it through the FDA. And then they would turn to me. So Daniel has told you all about what's possible. I feel like I'm going to have to come behind and say just about anything's possible. Let's talk about what's practical and what's actually going to happen. And I'm sure we're going to have a great discussion about this afterwards. So I'll get through it here, and hopefully we'll all learn something. Let me just say that I do think this is an amazing time. I agree with Daniel about that. And the slide he showed from the diagram we did together, we had never met. We ended up at an NIH meeting where they brought together grantees, and the idea was to brainstorm about the future. I learned a heck of a lot then, and that diagram came from it. Much of what's on that diagram is in transition now. Mark didn't mention that between my two FDA stints, I worked at Google in the Alphabet family of companies. Almost everything he showed, we were working on. Unfortunately for me, in a way, my job was always to point out what's wrong and what's not working out of all the efforts that are going on. So everything he showed, I could give you an hour-long lecture about what the problems are and the issues that we need to address. But despite that, if you look at that diagram 10 years ago, much of it is very much in motion now. I would argue that in the United States, we are the world's innovator. We are the biomedical hub that's making the difference. But we're inventing all kind of amazing things. The rest of the world is figuring out how to use them better. But if we put it together in a particular way, much along the lines that Daniel said, I think we do have the opportunity now to move into a different era of health in this country. So the talk I'm going to give is from the FDA perspective. I want you to understand that. If I gave the talk from a different perspective, it would look a bit different, but these are the topics that I'm dealing with and thinking about every day. So first of all, I found that just like 2016 and 2022, everybody has an opinion about the FDA almost every day, because things we do affect so many people. So I think it's always worthwhile to spend a minute just telling you what the FDA actually does, because most people don't have a good idea of the scope of what we're involved in at the FDA. First of all, we're a regulatory agency. Everybody knows that. Our job is to keep people like Daniel under control so that he doesn't go marching into the future too fast. But deeply embedded in the history of the FDA is a fundamental reliance on science. And that's essential because we get taken to court a lot, and all the precedents in court is that if you're a science-based agency, then judges shouldn't, as a matter of course, overrule a scientific decision. If we were just a political entity, any judge would feel just as capable as a politician about making that decision. So that keeps us whole. But what's in the center of the thinking of people that work at the FDA is the public health, and I'll go into that. It is an amazing congruence of different professions. It's a very interesting place to work because of this. I don't know, Mark, about you, but as a cardiologist, by the way, let me just say, you learn a lot about somebody if you're in a coronary care unit in the middle of the night with a sick patient making decisions about surgery. I'll tell you, you're lucky to have Mark here. You really see into somebody's soul when they're under pressure to make those decisions, and you've got someone who I think has a deep internal compass and will make good decisions. But along the way, whenever I encountered lawyers, it was never good. Lawyers usually were bringing us bad news. But the FDA has a large number of lawyers, and I've really gotten to see a different side of how the intersection of public policy and law and health can work. We do regulate about a fifth to a quarter of the economy. So just about anything you can think of in one way or another, any company you can think of or any medical center, we regulate it. It begins with food. You'll notice FDA, the first letter is food, and that's deeply embedded in the history. It's really important to Kentucky. It's a big part of controversy right now because people feel that food has not gotten its fair shake at the FDA, and I'm spending a lot of time working on it. I got to say, prior to 2016, I knew almost nothing about cosmetics, but cosmetics is something that we also regulate. Here's the quiz for you. What's the average number of cosmetics that a woman uses in a day in the United States? Well, the answer is 12. Now, that's something, but here's the shocker. What's the average number of cosmetics that a man uses in a day in the United States? The answer is 6. So if you think about deodorant, shampoo, all the different things that we do, it's a big deal. The most underappreciated part of the FDA is the Center for Veterinary Medicine, which has a major role, also very important to Kentucky. I'm going to have a meeting later on today with the School of Agriculture about hemp, which is a really essential part of the economy of Kentucky going forward. And we've got to figure out how to regulate it, given its relationship to all the other products. I think we're up to 38 different cannabis products now that are out there, many of them illegal. Some of them legal, like hemp, through action led out of Kentucky. Everybody knows about drugs. Devices, which as Daniel has pointed out, increasingly are not just physical entities, but integrated combinations of digital and physical technologies. Cell and gene therapy is the thing that's growing the fastest right now. We just had our budget for the next 5 years approved through the user fees with the industry, and the fastest growing area in the budget is going to be cell gene regenerative medicine. A lot of activity there. And then we got tobacco, which is the adolescent of the FDA, only just over a decade in existence. But to show the creativity and ingenuity in America, just as we think we're getting tobacco under better regulation, vaping comes along. And who would have thought that in the course between 2016, when we started to regulate vaping, and the time the applications came in 2020, there were 6.7 million vaping products. 6.7 million. I could have never imagined that we would invent so many different products in a technology like that. So that's what we regulate. Now, what's the mission? Number one at the FDA is protecting the public. And I would just say that for everything that Daniel showed you, 95% of people are trying to do the right thing with it. There's some proportion always trying to do the wrong thing. Tuesday I was in Houston for the day, and we have a major office of criminal investigation there. So we had a two-hour show and tell where I got to see just about every aspect of what's in progress in terms of criminal activity related to things that we regulate. Let me tell you, the ingenuity of criminals is just as great as what Daniel showed you, the ingenuity of people trying to do the right thing. But right there with protecting the public is advancing public health by speeding innovation. And you can see there's a balance here. If you turn it loose completely, you'll get a lot of innovation, but a lot of people will get harmed along the way. If you hold it back too much, you don't get the advantages that you need, although the traditional safety may be better. And then the second part of this is the one that I think I just completely underestimated coming into the FDA in our mission, helping the public get accurate science-based information. And I'm going to talk more about that later. But just put yourself in the shoes. You come to work. You've got 320 million people at all different levels of knowledge and understanding, multiple languages, multiple reading levels. And you've got to get information across to them to help guide them through the use of those products. And then tobacco really has a life in and of itself. And I do want to pause here for just a second to talk about Kentucky and tobacco. I got some new slides this morning. I didn't have a chance to put them in. You guys got some work to do is all I can say. You're going to lose about 8,000 people this year due to tobacco-related illnesses. You're not that big of a state in population-wise. In America, we're going to lose 500,000 people this year from tobacco-related illnesses. We still have 30 million people that are using tobacco products, and we got multiple millions of teenagers now addicted to nicotine through vaping. So we have an enormous amount of work to do to get this under control and to get it in the right place, however that's going to be defined. And then finally, this is one that in 2016, when I showed our mission, people sort of scratched their heads like, what are you talking about? But I think after the pandemic, people are not scratching their heads anymore. There is a tremendous amount of work that has to go on, totally independent of anything that's currently happening, to be prepared for the next emergency situation. And although we haven't done perfectly in the pandemic, I'll talk more about that. If not, for all of the work that goes on day to day throughout all the federal agencies, we would have really been in trouble. We wouldn't have a vaccine that works in the time that we had it. And I just want to mention that, you know, the thing I'm very concerned about right now, that we are as prepared as we can be for is nuclear catastrophe. We're as close. Some of you are probably alive like I was in the Cuban Missile Crisis, where you were told to hide under the desk. I think we know hiding under the desk is not going to be sufficient right now if things go wrong in the Ukraine the way that we're worried about, and we're going we have to be prepared for emergency response on a national and global basis for this. So that's what we do at the FDA. How does it play out in terms of the public health? Well, I just have to say right now, not so well. And I'm very concerned about where we're headed as a country in terms of our public health. I want to just show you a sort of depressing set of slides about it. This is a look at life expectancy in the United States for men and women. By the way, I am a man, and I just always feel like I have to point out the group that's living longer is women, not men. And we have a lot of reason to have special programs for women's health, but men are the ones that need the help right now more than anything. This gap in the latest data is now widening considerably. That is, women are living even longer than men as we go forward. But you'll notice that in around 2010, our increase in life expectancy started to plateau, and it's now clearly declining. And I'll show more about this as we go through it. Now, you could say, well, the pandemic, of course, it's declining. But the problem is that, first of all, it's not homogeneous. Different parts of our population are declining at different rates. And secondly, and at least I know you all are basketball. Let's see if we can. Looks like the slides are stuck. I know you all are basketball fans. By the way, I came in my Blue Devil bow tie today because I wore a Blue Devil tie last time I was here. It didn't go over all that well then. But I'd asked Mark to get me a Kentucky tie, so we switched ties. You'll note I'm wearing the Kentucky tie today. But what really should get our attention is here. Whoops. Let's see if we can make it go back. The gap in life expectancy between the United States and other high-income countries. In 2010, we were living about 2 years shorter than the average of other high-income countries. That gap has widened. And now during the pandemic, it's blown up so that we now have an average life expectancy that's 5 years shorter than the average of other high-income countries. And of note, China passed us in life expectancy this year, something I never thought that I would see. And so we've got very significant work to do if we're going to turn this around. I'm going to have a different way to advance the slides, I think. There we go. And then, of course, in order to get this inferior result in our health outcomes, we're spending a heck of a lot more money. You'll notice here, if we go back to the 1970s, almost all of the high-income countries sort of aggregated together in terms of life expectancy and what we were spending on healthcare. Over time, all the other countries have migrated as a bunch. There's one outlier, the United States, which has a dramatically lower life expectancy and a dramatically higher cost at the same time. So this is something that as Daniel promulgates all this technology upon us, we've got to answer the question, are we going to use it to get better outcomes at a lower cost, or are we just going to continue to blow out the budget and not have much to show for it in terms of the health outcomes that we achieve? Let's go to the next slide. And I don't need to tell you that the results are homogeneous. I feel totally okay talking about this. I'm from South Carolina. South Carolina and Kentucky are very similar in terms of health outcomes, but you'll note, depending on where you live in the United States, there's up to a 20-year difference in life expectancy. Daniel showed that. Go to the next slide. What really should get our attention is that these differences are widening. They're not coming together. And the place that has the worst outcomes and the continued worsening of outcomes relative to the rest of the country is the part of the country we're in now. It's the Appalachian region and the Southeast. Again, I'm from the Carolinas. We're all part of this. And we've got to figure out what to do so that we don't continue to have these vast differences that are continuing to grow. Now, don't pay attention to the details here. Daniel made the point, which you all know, that the social determinants dominate if you look at what's behind this. It's wealth, education, race, ethnicity. But in addition to that, if you look at the second tranche of factors here, how is it manifested clinically? It's things that we know how to treat. It's obesity, physical activity, cigarette smoking, blood pressure, diabetes. These are things that are not foreign objects to us. We understand them reasonably well. We're just not doing a good job of executing on the things that we already know. And if you just put that in terms of what are the top 10 causes of death and loss of life expectancy now, right there at the top is my specialty, ischemic heart disease, something that I think we sort of took for granted that we understood it. I know Mark has spent his career working on heart disease, and yet we're now going in the wrong direction in this country in terms of the heart disease statistics. And of course, what's changing the most in terms of getting worse far and away is drug use disorders. And we're going to have another meeting later on this morning with all the expertise that you put together here. And I got to say, when I got the information about the University of Kentucky Health System programs compared to when I was here last time, I think you've made tremendous progress in putting the building blocks in place for the things that are needed and the areas that are most important. But we got to make this work because I'm giving you the picture here that it's not going in the right direction now. And of course, the one that I talk about the most, it's very hard to, I found people don't like to talk about this too much, but it is very dramatic. The biggest change that's happening in the United States right now in health outcomes is the difference between urban and rural people. And in fact, even in states like California, where I lived for 5 years, if you go three counties away from San Francisco, you're in Lake County, there's a 12-year difference in life expectancy. And if you look at the Southeast and you draw a circle around university towns, they look a lot like California in terms of life expectancy, but go two counties away and you're into the same problem. And you'll notice the trajectory here. We were all together until about 1990, and this difference is magnifying and continuing to increase. And I'm sure we're going to get into this during the discussion. Is technology helping this, or is it hurting it? Is an interesting question. And then the latest data are a little bit depressing. These disparities are continuing to widen during the pandemic. And if you put us in the league of countries, let's go back. I don't know how many of you follow Ted Lasso. I don't know that much about soccer. One of my sons was a great soccer player, and I used to go to the games. I could never figure it out. I'm a basketball fan, where you expect to make about 30 to 40% of your shots. And soccer, it seems like there are all these shots, and every once in a while the ball goes in the goal. I could never figure out why it happened. But one thing about Ted Lasso is I learned about the leagues in the UK. You'll notice the country in last place here in our league for life expectancy. The difference widening, we would be relegated to the next league if we were in a soccer league with this kind of performance. So this is the latest up-to-date data. It's something that I believe is an emergency we need to take seriously, and it's something that's not sustainable. Now, we're going to be short on time, so I'm going to rush through the part about evidence generation, but I just have one thing I want to say about it, and I think you are really working at this, but we got to do better. In order for us to know what to do in these interventions, we have to do the research to figure out what works and what doesn't. And I notice you all are garnering a lot more NIH funding. I think it's something you should be really proud of. But guessing what's going to work has proven not to be a very effective approach. And so we've got to work together to take all these ideas that people like Daniel have and to put them to the test. We have a saying at FDA, in God we trust, all others must bring evidence. And what we'd really like to see is not just evidence about devices, drugs, and biologics, but evidence about agriculture, how we should eat, how we should put diets together, evidence about healthcare services interventions, how to make them the most effective, a big issue that I know you all are working on. Now, I'm going to skip through this part because I want to get to the discussion. But the whole purpose of all this is just to say, let's please work together to take advantage. I understand you went to Epic also recently, like most of the rest of the country. I have mixed feelings about Epic historically, as Mark knows. But the fact is now, it is what it is, and it's an amazing opportunity that we all have electronic health records. We shouldn't struggle to have data to understand what we're doing because we're all using the same systems now. And we've got to put the human systems together to make it work so that it's not unusual to do a randomized trial when the answer to the question is not known. But it's just a normal part of life that we're constantly monitoring what we're doing. And when there's a question, we do a clinical trial in the context of the healthcare delivery system, not as some separate standalone activity. It's something we're very much, as a policy, working on right now at the FDA. I'll go through. And you'll hear a lot over the next couple of months, if you follow this, about accelerated approvals. Americans have made it clear through Congress that they want access to treatments earlier. And so over half the drugs we now approve are based on an accelerated basis, where we don't have the human clinical trials to know what the outcomes are going to be. We do it based on biomarkers like Daniel showed. But the bargain for that, the return on the bargain, is that the industry and you all really need, really need to fill in the data in the post-market phase, because we're finding, and there's a big hearing actually coming up next week of a drug that was thought to be highly effective in a condition, and looks like it's probably not now that the data's been filled in. And so we're going to take more risk with drugs that we put on the market. That's something the public has spoken about. In order for us to get this right, we're going to have to work together to get the answers in the post-market phase. I'm going to get all the way through this to the part I really want to emphasize here closing. I'm on record now saying I think this is the largest cause of death in the United States now. If you look at what's underlying these statistics that I showed you, we could do a lot better with the fancy technology, and I love fancy technology. I worked at Google for 5 years. It is so much fun and so interesting. But basically, what's causing this underlying deterioration in American health is a set of bad decisions that are being made in everyday life about what we eat, what we ingest, how we use products like tobacco, getting addicted to drugs. And much of that is driven now by the very same technology that Daniel and I both love called the internet. It's something that has really taken hold and is almost impossible to defeat. In fact, we don't have a strategy right now that's a winning strategy. One of the great things about being FDA commissioner is almost 100% of my calls get returned. There's certain congresspeople who don't return my calls unless they're mad, and then they call and expect me to return the call. And so I've talked to everybody I know who's an expert in misinformation. We know a lot about it now. It's a subject of a lot of academic study, and I hope at University of Kentucky there's a whole group of people working and thinking about this. I can't find a single expert who can credibly put forth a strategy that will turn around the fact that we're losing the battle on misinformation right now. Just to be clear about the terminology, because I think it's really important to distinguish, misinformation, for the most part, are well-intentioned people who just got it wrong, and because they can now go on the internet and be just as authoritative as Mark or Daniel on day one, they can influence a lot of people. Disinformation is intended to harm people. It might just be by taking their money, and I'm looking forward to publicizing some of the things I saw in Houston about what people are doing that's frankly misleading people into doing very dangerous things. You may have seen the NyQuil chicken memes. It became a big thing among teenagers to cook your chicken in NyQuil, which is not a very good way to stay alive if you've done that, but it became a daring contest. But the other one I want to mention is malinformation. Malinformation is not only intended to do harm, it's systematically intended to do harm, and often funded by governments that are adversaries of the United States. On the internet, it's very hard to sort out which is which. And this is one of the struggles that we have. We need to work together on this. Surgeon General Vivek Murthy made this a priority very early on in the administration, and I was all fired up about it. I was working at Google at the time, and I called him, because he was Surgeon General my first time through. I said, Vivek, this is great. He said, well, I got one problem. I got a staff of 3 people, so I need some help if we're going to take this on. So he's publicized it, and I would urge you to read his report, because I think it's a very common sense description of what the issues are that we are struggling with, and he called for us to all work together on it. And we do know some things that we can do. When you see it, we need to explicitly call attention to it, and it can be uncomfortable because it's often couched in cultural terms which cause people to be divided. We have to more reliably elevate truthful information. And when we see somebody that's actively promoting disinformation, we need to take them on because they can become extremely powerful. You may have noticed yesterday Alex Jones got on the internet and called for the killing of Pfizer executives. the people that invented the vaccines. These kind of things have serious consequences. But I think the most important part relates directly to you guys. You are a state-funded institution. You have tentacles all over the state of Kentucky. We know that the most effective way to counter misinformation is through human interpersonal interaction with someone that you trust. If we don't build this in as an active part of our medical education, what our doctors and nurses and pharmacists do in day-to-day work, we're going to lose. And the way I used to describe this when I worked at Google was, we could see that people, when they came out of your clinics, were immediately getting on their cell phones and Googling what they thought you were saying, because usually in the 15 minutes that they had with the doctor and the nurse, they didn't really understand what you were talking about. And when they Google it, they could get access to anybody's opinion, which may or may not be the truth. And unless you're actively dealing with that, we got a problem. Now, we have the burning platform in front of us today. This is the latest data. I won't do it, but I could talk for hours about, you know, I'm a cardiologist. We develop the treatments for heart attacks. You all use them very effectively here. This is like 10 times better evidence than what we had for heart attacks, and I thought that was phenomenal. Basically, if you're up to date on your vaccination, and if you get infected and you're high risk, it is almost impossible to die from COVID. If you're not up to date on your vaccination and you get infected when you're high risk and you don't get Paxlovid, you got a significant risk of being dead, multiple times higher risk of being dead. And in our VA system, with this latest Omicron wave, they've already produced the data showing exactly the same thing: dramatic effect on the risk of being dead or having to go in the hospital. Here's Kentucky right now. You guys are not at the bottom of the pack, but you're not at the top of the pack either. And you have an opportunity every time a patient is seen to, in a human way, make the case that the most important thing, and I think this is true for any people you see except those who are really, really sick at the time you see them, the most important thing they can do to optimize the chances they'll be around for the holidays would be to get up to date on the vaccination, both COVID and flu right now, because we're in for a bad flu season. And you'll see today from the CDC some new statistics. We have some very nasty variants that are on the rise now in the US. So the wave that we predicted and developed the updated vaccine for looks like it's likely to happen. So there's a lot at stake in the interactions you have with patients right now to get them vaccinated. And you're gonna have to overcome a lot of misinformation to do it, because they're getting a lot of information during the course of time that's counter. It's kind of depressing when you look at what to expect from the surveys being done. Only a third of adults have gotten boosted with the previous boost, and yet we know there was an 80% reduction in risk of death for those who got boosted before. And when we look at what people are planning, a lot of people have just written it off. Many people have just tuned out. They're not even aware of it. And I've made a habit of asking people. It's been really interesting, some of the conversations I've had as I travel around. So I'll close with this. The point here is that this is nothing new. There actually were snake oil salesmen. But the way they advertised was through print, through magazines and newspapers. Now a snake oil salesman can get right on the internet, and it's almost impossible for us to stop it. We can't regulate it the way we can what you do in a medical clinic or what a medical company does. And unless we wake up and deal with this, I think we're headed for the same trajectory that we're currently on, which is something that I hope we don't all want. So I'll stop there. I'm sorry I had trouble with the slides. I'm not sure if something I did to the slide said. It's probably some FDA firewall that got in the way as we're dealing with it. And I look forward to the discussion.
So we're going going to go ahead and bring the screen up, and we've got, again, I want to thank several of you in the audience who sent questions. We're going to go through a few questions, some of them nice and controversial, to engender some additional thought. You can have the middle. All right, I'm going to go, I'm going to start with one that Rob kind of alluded to a few minutes ago. Technology appears, we talked a lot about technology, appears to be a two-edged sword for our underserved population. Does that help narrow or expand the gap that we see with the health of the underrepresented populations, including the elderly?
I'll start as the sometimes techno-optimist. I mean, I think, you know, how many from rural areas to others where it may be hundreds of miles to have a pediatric psychiatrist specialist available or a dermatologist that isn't going to take three months to be seen. So big picture, I think it narrows the disparities. Almost every, you know, the bottom billion on the planet have smartphones in many places, and soon we'll have high-speed internet. And so while digital health and telemedicine isn't the be-all, end-all, at least can give somebody basic access. And now, as the advancements of, you know, AI diagnostics come along, you can have a bit of an AI doc do triage at least, and then up-level you to the need. So I think it gives people more empowerment to be in touch with their own health data. It can be now communicated in the right language and the right culture. Certainly it can be misused as well. I mean, AI can be used for good or for bad. 3D printing can print a gun or a medical device. But I think overall it can narrow the disparities.
Rob?
Well, I think the answer is clear in the U.S. right now. It's widening the disparities. But that's not because it should widen the disparities. I completely agree with the potential that's there. I mean, you look at your state, you got a lot of people. You know, it's not a surprise that super specialists want to aggregate in Lexington. And, you know, I lived in San Francisco. There was a reason for that. And so people that live 3 hours from a clinic, you know, you can deliver very good care directly to them, but for whatever reason, we're not doing it. There's a quote, I'll mention two things about it. There's a quote that really got my attention in The Atlantic a couple of weeks ago. It was related to some things about the pandemic. The quote was, "Technological solutions walked into the penthouses of America. Diseases seep into the cracks of America." And so what we're seeing is the people who are worse off are continuing to suffer. The people that, like you and me, you know, the minute something comes out, I jump on it and I'm ready to go and I'm already super connected. So I'll also say, during my time at Google, we really worked hard on trying to make healthcare technologies a leavening process, but it didn't seem to matter what we did. If it was good, the highly educated wealthy just got right to it and took off with it. And I think there's an issue here for Kentucky that I think is really important. There's a lot of money going into making the internet available for everybody. I think that's going to happen. But I think it would be a tremendous use of your health system to hire community health workers who are out there in your small towns, in the rural areas, going into the homes of elderly people and helping them get connected and use the technology. It doesn't help much to have an internet connection if you're not able to use it. And most people, if they have a human being helping them, can figure out how to use it.
I do think that one of the things for UK and UK healthcare with our extension service and having, essentially, we have people in every county in the state that are there. They're there originally for agriculture, but now again, there's education, you know, there's again health as a more focus on what they do. So I do think it's an opportunity, something we do need to take more advantage of as we go forward. If we talk about, with all this misinformation, we'll go to misinformation in a minute, Rob. With all this misinformation that is out there around vaccines and medications, how do we move forward trying to protect the public? What role can UK or UK healthcare play?
I think I said it, I'll say it again. And I really did, I mean, it was palpable at at Google since, you know, Google search, like it or not, is almost a monopoly. I'm not supposed to use that word, but it's dominant as a search engine. So whether you're going to the FDA, you know, how do you get to the FDA website? You Google it, right? So you could just see that people are searching for information, and they're gonna gravitate to the most attractive source, not necessarily the most authoritative. So unless we re-engineer our clinical services that we're consciously aware that people are being influenced by things other than what the doctor or the nurse or pharmacist is saying, we're not gonna win this battle. Because I think fundamentally, doctors, nurses, pharmacists, the professions you're training, they give pretty good advice about what works and what should be done, but it's drowned out right now by all the other information that people get. I'll also say all the experts 100% agree the government can't solve this problem. I would guess you agree with me. A federal official telling Kentuckians to get vaccinated is probably
not going to help.
probably not the most successful approach. But so we need a fabric of medical schools and health systems to come together and really focus on this. It's something the government can't fix.
You do wonder a little bit from the standpoint, because a lot of this was driven through the government, it became, we politicized a lot of aspects of this and care. And how do we take the medical side, which has usually been your local doctor, your local hospital, people that you respect and see or talk to, and how do we transition that? How do we put those two together a little bit in the future? Because I think especially in states like Kentucky, that would be helpful in trying to communicate and get that information to the local community.
Yeah, I mean, you know me, I'm a cardiologist who cut my teeth with heart attack care, and you know, people said it was simple because you just had to know if someone's dead or alive. Even a cardiologist can figure that out, but I don't think it ought to matter if you're a Republican or a Democrat. You ought to recommend for your patients the things that lower their risk of being dead. And this is just as clear as it can be. One example.
I was going to say, sometimes it's, you know, maybe we can communicate in things in new ways. I think when the polio vaccine came out, the big transition was when Elvis took it, and that opened up the gates. I don't know who the latest TikToker would be to help promulgate some of these. It needs to come from different channels. And even the CDC, I mean, there's not as much design thinking as there could be in how you communicate it to match age, culture, language, political affiliation. So there's some ways to communicate that may not be as traditionally used to get this out there. And I'd also say, I mean, in terms of misinformation, we have physicians out there, like this famous guy, Dr. Merkelai. Why does he still have a medical license? You know, I can think of how many folks did one or two folks now with the power of the internet getting their voice out there amplify the misinformation, and how do we even hold them to account? So maybe it's a blend of some constraints as well as better ways to communicate.
Let me just add, you know, since I live in the land of political strife right now in Washington, If there was a way to depoliticize the question of life and death, that, because a lot of the, like TikTok, I'm sorry, but rural Kentuckians are not big TikTok users. People in California and young people are.
Right. There's different channels.
The people dying are the older people in rural areas. So some smart people have got to figure out how to depoliticize these kinds of questions.
One of the questions, how do you balance the overwhelming need to meet healthcare needs in a state like Kentucky with the aspirations to improve health? Both are, it can be resource intensive, may not have to be, but, and the workforce seems overwhelming, right? I mean, we have more patients trying to get to us every day than we can get into the beds and the things that we do. And so the idea of that pivot is a great idea. But, you know, it's a challenge, right? Because the resources we have are focused on that far end of the sick care, if you talked about. So, Dan, you want to start with that?
Well, I mean, one level is, like, I love the idea of the community health worker. You can upskill someone who doesn't have to have the MD or even the RN to do a lot of things, from screening, contact tracing, mental health care, as well as, you know, shifting things to even addressing the infodemic, smart education earlier when kids in elementary and high school to understand what is health data, what's a vaccine, what's a clinical trial. And then, you know, simple stuff. I mean, we talked about technology maybe having disparities, but, you know, in terms of it takes a while, but you know, simple, we know, 30 minutes of exercise 3 times a week, you know, has the best benefit for cardiovascular disease, diabetes, mental health, cancer risk. So, I mean, how do you shift the mindsets to get folks more proactive earlier in their health span that impacts things later and takes the hurt off? So that's one element.
You know, one point I wanted to make that I couldn't today because I had so much trouble getting the doggone slides to advance.
AIGV, AV is hard.
I feel like as people develop technologies, I think I'm a little biased, but I think we're doing a great job of the phase 1, 2, 3 pre-market assessment of technologies. But because, as I said, so many of them are being approved now based on biomarkers without really knowing the health effects, we don't have a system in this country to generate that next level of evidence. And if other countries can spend 20 to 30% less money and get better outcomes, that's telling us that we're doing a bunch of stuff that doesn't really work. If we could figure out what the stuff is that doesn't really work and get rid of it, you could focus your high-tech effort here, which I don't want to get rid of. I mean, if I have a heart attack or a stroke or cancer, I want to come in a place like this and get the very best. But I would love it if you could do it really efficiently and not spend a bunch of money on things that don't work. And to know what doesn't work, we have to generate the evidence. That's why I'm so stuck on the evidence generation part of this. Otherwise, we're just going to continue to run up, you know, another great quote that I heard a couple of months ago, the business of healthcare has never been better. Now, I know hospitals are having a down year this year, but if you look over time, everybody's been making money, but health of America is going the opposite direction. So we need to get the two in sync.
And one of the reasons maybe we both have that chart of how other countries have done better, they do spend more of the money on the proactive preventative pieces. Everyone has some more basic level elements, so they're not waiting to the phase 2, 3 sick care side on the extreme. That's one. And I just want to go back to another point back on the infodemic. And I know one of your Google colleagues, I'm an Aspen fellow with, how you even engineer the searches and how they show what information when you ask a question can have a dramatic impact about how you learn and how you take the next step. So there's the engineering of the results. And a small example of that, I got COVID right before the vaccines became available, and I was doing some searches about what was available. And I got a ping on Facebook of all things, have you been recently contracted COVID? Are you interested in being part of a clinical trial? And I hit the yes button. The next day I had the drug and an app and a blood pressure cuff and fluvoxamine, which is a good off-label drug that has some evidence. So sometimes how do you take the searches and provide the information someone needs is helpful.
So one of the things, talking about, you know, the FDA regulates medical devices, correct? And the safety of the measurement seems to be tied with how clinicians or caregivers use the information. So how do we, and it goes towards implementation a little bit, right? How do we know the potential outcomes or issues that we create as we drive that type of technology?
I think this is a huge issue that should be like a wide open playing field for a place like this. You know, at FDA, we by law cannot interfere with the practice of medicine. So we have a discontinuous system. We regulate, is the measurement accurate? But then the next phase is, if you have an accurate measurement, how is a clinician or a patient going to use it? What decisions are being driven? And, you know, there's a rich literature now on the fact that interface has got a lot of problems. So I think that's what the question's alluding to. And we need a renaissance in diagnosis, but the point is, it's not enough to just put a measurement out there. And in fact, you could argue, and you lived through this, Mark. Remember when operating rooms had very little digital measurement, and then people started putting in all these machines? I think you guys made a lot of errors, or not you personally, but a lot of errors early
on. Not me.
Because you couldn't tell the artifact from the truth, and it was confusing. Sort of like what happened to airplane cockpits.
Right.
And then it got organized into a system which really provides decision support. Now you can read the newspaper and go take a break, as I understand it, you know, during the middle of an operation.
He put these kind of digs in when we were at Duke too, so don't worry. Nothing has really changed.
but
This is an area that I think should be right down the alley of medical schools and academic health systems, because it's sort of a mess right now. We're proliferating tests and technologies, and a lot of times people don't know what to do with them. They're doing their best, but you can just count the errors in retrospect from these errors. There is some legislation in play about this right now. Our biggest opponent in that legislation is academic medical centers, because there seems to be some belief that you guys always do the right thing, no matter what. And somehow I have a little suspicion about that.
And you guys, you know, included you for many years. So yeah. let me put that back in there. Dan?
I mean, you mentioned the airplane thing, and I had a couple analogies. I mean, I learned to fly with the round dials and the paper maps, and I can't remember how I used to fly that way, and I just started flying again with a glass cockpit. And the amount of synthesized information, you know, GPS, where's the airport, what frequency, where's the other traffic, gives you a whole nother level of insight. Even just, I drove here Tesla, first time I've driven a Tesla. You see the cars around you, you know when it's safe to change a lane. You can even see the car ahead of the car. So, I mean, now we have all these data sources, of which I mentioned, and some are regulated, some not. You know, you get what you measure, but now we have new ways to put them together, and it has to do with the UI that can hopefully, you know, not just be alarm fatigue and the machine that goes bing, but give you that early proactive piece. So how do you design the user interface that really matches the clinical situation or the patient, the clinician, or the caregiver and outside perspectives?
So the patient interface, in some ways, how do they take, what do they do with the information they're getting? Because I think that you could think about COPD, or that is, you know, and things are oxygen driven for their respiratory response. Mm-hmm. Their pulse ox falls and they turn up their oxygen, they'll continue to, you know, to do poorly, right? I mean, as a component, it may make sense to them that as their sat falls, it would make sense to turn up your oxygen flow. Whereas it may be something that actually, you know, harms them, because we don't have an easy process for what they want to do.
And some of that, maybe, is this whole idea of gamification. Now we learn from video games and what incentivizes people. Like my little Oura Ring, I gamify my sleep. I don't need to look at all my REM and deep and light. I get a synthesized score. So that I want to hit my 80 or 90 and asleep, and I'll go to bed a little earlier. So it's an example of taking sometimes complex information and scorifying it, and sometimes leveraging, you know, some people need incentives of points or dollars or badges or social cred. Some of that can help folks get more engaged with their particular chronic disease management.
Have an interesting question. It goes a little bit to your thoughts on health systems maybe going in the opposite way of health. Going forward, if you were going to judge the success of a health system, what would be the key metric or measure that you would look forward to use?
In my ideal world, it would be the health of the population served. And of course, the issue there, I mean, what is the main use of AI in medical information right now? It's to segment populations according to profitability in the US. And I got to see this big time at Alphabet about that same technology could be used to reduce disparities. But the point I want to make is, it seems obvious to me that if you paid people to facilitate better health outcomes for the people they served, that would align things so that the right incentives would be there. But the best way to get the best outcomes in your population right now is to pick the patients that are going to do the best. Insurance companies learned that a long time ago. It's a thriving consulting business to help. I'm sure you would never do that, Mark, but
not at all.
It's a thriving business. So for that to work, you've got to have a scheme where people actually are accountable for a defined population and can't pick and choose who they serve.
Dan?
I don't know, you get what you measure, and sometimes, you know, we're measuring hemoglobin A1C or blood pressure, and maybe it's not, with some of these new digital and other tools, there's whole new ways of having digital biomarkers, and there's a whole class of those which could be plugged into clinical trials. But I would think holistically, I would measure it by the ability now to take someone's personal information, omics and others, and start to use that much more proactively to keep them healthy, and as opposed to waiting for the sick care side. So can you start to implement something that's not just one size fits all, and start to see that over time you're leading less heart attacks, strokes, et cetera, that are preventable, and get people engaged in that early, as opposed to waiting to go to Dr. Welby.
Okay, let's argue for a minute, second. If I'm all for that, it's the right thing to do ultimately. But the reason I jump to health outcomes as opposed to that intermediate step is the minute you start down that road, who's gonna take advantage of it? Mm-hmm. And the people that need it the most are the least likely to be able to take advantage of it, unless we're incentivized to put resources into helping them to be able to do it. So if you got the same incentives for that as you did for your next expensive cancer chemotherapy, it would look different.
I will get to one of the things that we've worked with the state and the federal government on. We have now a Medicaid value-based payment program that markedly incentivizes us to look at that Medicaid population, to look at that group we serve, Rob, and to hit those targets, to be able to say well child visits, to be able to say immunization, to be able to say, again, colon cancer screening, breast cancer screening. And it's made a whole new focus for us on that population, because literally we have to look at what that denominator is, understand it, and try to, because some of it is even just getting that patient to come in. It is not necessarily what we do, it's getting them to engage as a part of that process. So I agree, it's a good thing, but it's a ways away from most of what we have done for a long time.
Yeah, I know I'm picking to try to make it entertaining, but I think you should be really proud of that program. It's what's needed. The trends I showed, I would argue, are most likely to be affected by those kinds of programs.
And sometimes, like, you just need to bring them in. You can go to where they are. There's the famous barbershop models for African Americans getting blood pressure screening, and what you could do with small devices the dentist or the barbershop can help engage people and get them screened and educated in different ways.
Last, I think this will probably be our last question. It'll be FDA oriented, but I think it hits between the two. Is that some people, again, you know, have expressed, you know, concern about when we move to faster development of drugs, that increases the probability of, you know, again, of not knowing things. I mean, you hear that a lot with vaccines. I'm going to wait, right, to see what happens. I'm going to talk about, you know, the different things. I mean, as we think about that balance, because you're right, people want those drugs, devices, everything faster to market, faster to capability, but it gives people concern about, you know, the relative safety of what we're doing. How do we balance that? What is the communication that we, and how do we do that? We'll start with Dan.
Well, I mean, sometimes it's I'm not in the regulatory space, but I would say there's the potential to measure things differently, and obviously now with some machine learning and organ on a chip and digital twin modeling, you can run a virtual clinical trial in some cases. And obviously, mouse to human doesn't always translate as quickly. But we're learning to better make those correlations, better humanize models. So that's one way to I think speed things up and check safety. And then there's new ways to make clinical trials not just democratize through the virtual trial space, but leverage, you know, the trial at home. When I did that trial for COVID, it got delivered the next day with an app, and means it can be more real world. So you can do the aftermarket elements. You can get folks more engaged in being part of the data donor element. So that might be one way of speeding things up and seeing safety and using our computational models to do that. Because we're now in this era of synthetic biology, and mRNA is not going to just be used for vaccines for infectious diseases, but for Alzheimer's and cardiovascular disease and beyond. So. Over to you.
Trying to make three quick points about this, and I've already mentioned this, but the question is right on target, because we are moving to earlier approval for marketing of medical products of all types, where less is known. We have biomarkers. In most cases, the law actually says that are reasonably likely to predict clinical benefit, not proven. And so we've got to fill in this gap in knowledge that we have by generating real evidence, often using randomization. And we're going to find a lot of times it is riskier. But, you know, most things in life, no pain, no gain. If you don't take risk, you don't get benefit. I'm okay with that. But the problem we have is if we take the risk and something is actually harmful, not beneficial, and we don't do the studies, we may not ever know it.
Right.
And that's a real significant problem. Point number two, I'm totally with all the fancy organs on a chip and synthetic biology and virtual clinical trials and all this kind of stuff. We're working hard on it at the FDA. I would just say there's a big difference between showing that something can work in the theory and then actually proving that it works most of the time so it can be a regulatory tool. We're having a lot of trouble getting the dreamers of the world to do the practical work because guess what? You know, as you know, Mark, because you did a lot of drug development trials, 90% of drugs that get into human clinical trials turn out not to work.
Right.
And every one of those had a lot of smart people working on them, a lot of investment money. So most things actually don't work. When something does work, it's sort of like a miracle, but then it's a phenomenal thing we need to take advantage of. So as we develop these new technologies, and I'd point out for vaccines, had not the academic, the industry, the FDA worked together for two decades on mRNA technology, it was like a miracle that it was ready to go because it was one of the first real uses of that technology. Now we can turn around a vaccine in 4 months from the time a new variant comes that's specific to that variant. It's almost like a cartridge that you just put into a technology. Then last point I want to make, it's different when you're in a pandemic. You mentioned vaccines again. In the normal world, I think the tradition at the FDA has been great for the public because if you have a great new idea, you have to put it to the test and let the evidence speak for itself. If it works, then you promote it. In a pandemic, if you wait to get the evidence, it's already swept through and it's too late. So that is the ultimate risk that you have to take. And but it wasn't hard to see early in the pandemic that, you know, I think globally, the last estimate was about 20 million fewer people have died in the U.S. It's well over a million. And if we had been successful in the implementation, it would be closer to 2 million people who would have been prevented from dying from that technology. So it actually, it's a proof of principle of what you're advocating. We just have to do it carefully. That's a message from the FDA.
So let me thank, I want to thank, please join me in thanking our participants. Dr. Califf and Dr. Kraft, this was great. It was fun for me. For all of you that are out there, we have tours of the health system starting next. And we also have, a lot of you are going to Keeneland this afternoon. Enjoy that. You know, it's just part of, again, and we're great. It's great to have you back on campus, and it's great to have all of the rest of our team together with you as we celebrate the 60th. Thank you all very much.